Hey, Randy, you want to be my dad?
Yeah, God, that would fucking... I'd be fucking pissed.
You would be so if mad.
If Randy got to be your dad, I'm like, we were all on the same fucking level. Then you fucking...
And then I just like ran... Then I ramped it up and pimped out my mom, and Randy's my dad.
I'd be really mad if Randy became your dad.
Brunch! Hit it, boys!
It's Monday and I was pissed.
You were very pissed. You were, in fact, you were rattled.
I was, no, no.
You were rattled.
I was out of my element.
Yeah, that's true. You definitely were.
I was a fish out of water. I don't do it often, but I experienced viral Twitter.
Yes.
I've always known it's just not for me. I'm a text tweeter. I tweet words. And that way, if it's good and it's funny, it will get 14 likes, and that's it. And the people who like it will explain to me, hey, I think you're the best, and that's all I need. If the graphics, the art, the videos and shit, that's what engages people more, and that's what will send you to
skyrocket
the fucking moon.
Yes.
So I put one out there today. You did it for me.
You consulted me.
I consulted you. I believe my request was, can you please give me this video?
Yes. And I did.
Yeah. So two of the officials during the Patriots game signaled for a safety at the same time. And I was like, I could make 100 fucking things out of this, out of just like claps.
Synchronized clapping, yeah.
Yes. So I was like, can you send me this? You sent me a GIF of it in like a second. I was like, thank you so much. I don't want a GIF. I need the video.
Yes.
And you're like, asshole. So I put that out there, did the ludicrous thing. Yeah, Ursher got the voice to make your booty go. And yeah, I just don't like it. You get your mentions, you don't see the normal things. So if Jim Murray or somebody liked something that I tweeted about the game, I wouldn't be able to see it because it's going to be buried with all this stuff. And the alerts that you get on your phone, you're getting alerts from people that you don't follow, but because Twitter thinks they're important enough, it's like, hey, I thought you'd like to know this guy. Like, a guy from fucking Shark Tank was tweeting about it. I had no fucking idea who it was. Like, I very much appreciate the people who live in that space. You obviously are a king in that space.
I've been there.
Shut up.
I've been there. Once or twice.
Yeah. I don't know how you fucking do it because, A, too much shit. You're seeing too many things. B, obviously, the ripoff artists.
Yes. Well, let's first get to the first part. What I've learned is it's basically once you get a tweet going viral, that's it for you. You got to kind of just shut off the Twitter machine for a couple of hours. And it's almost like well, fuck. Now I can't use Twitter for like a couple hours.
It's like you got, it's like getting warned in AOL Instant Messenger.
Yes.
You get warned a bunch. It's like, well, now you can't
take
message.
A fucking break.
Yeah, it's like, you know what? Go fucking set this one out. Which stinks because this happened during. So my job on Sundays is to see what the fun hot shit on the internet is. And during the Patriots pre- and post-game show, they cut to me and they're like, what's the fun hot shit on the internet? And I'm like, well, I saw this guy tweet this thing, and it's that thing. And it's lovely. Just terrific. Everyone loves it. And I couldn't do that because everything on Twitter was just...
You were getting flooded.
Alerts. And yeah, it's one of those things where I'm like, this is a really cool, great thing for someone.
Yeah.
Not
for you.
Not me.
You had a particularly hard time with the whole ripoff artist thing, which always happens, by the way.
I know.
It happens every time.
I texted you as soon as... So people started... I started getting the thing where your mentions are responses to tweets, and it's just your name.
Yes.
And I got a few of those, and I was like, uh-oh, what could this mean? I clicked on it. Someone had... They didn't do a quote tweet. They did an embed tweet. Which I know as that thing that I don't know how to do. I have no idea how to do that. Our social media coordinator at NBC Sports Boston, powered by Xfinity, I picked her brain about it, and she's like, dude, it's so easy. Just do this. Tatum Better, my favorite follow on Twitter,
yes,
does it all the time. I DM him every time, like, yo, how'd you do that? He tells me how to do it. I just don't know how to do it.
I don't know how to do it either, so
but
don't feel bad.
An embed tweet. I don't know how to say that word when you're not using it as a... as a verb, you
embedded,
know? Right? Because you're like, hey, can you embed that?
Yeah, embed.
But would you call it an embed tweet?
Embed
tweet.
Joel Embiid.
Ooh,
basketball guys.
He's on my fantasy basketball team, and my fantasy basketball team name is fucking bullshit because they're like, what do you think of it? And he's like, I think it's fucking bullshit. So my team name, fucking bullshit. Picture of Joel Embiid looking really pissed off.
Basketball guys.
Basketball.
Insert the
boom, 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 boom.
Big dicks playing basketball.
Bouncing over here, man. Shoot the J. So I
slam dunk.
So I saw that someone had done this. So I tweeted it with no words, no captions, no anything. And initially I was thinking of just doing the GIF and tweeting, Ursher got the voice to make your booty go, and it would just be the clap. And maybe that would have done better because
no, wouldn't some have.
Okay, good. No. So I thought whether it was the most engaging, the most accessible, whatever. For worse, I always do what is the funniest to me.
Yeah.
So I was so like I just the way I did it was the way I thought would be funniest. But it didn't have any sort of description. It didn't have any turn the sound on.
You're right.
So someone embed tweeted it with, turn the sound on if you want to have a great day or something. And that shit got way more retweets than mine did. And it's partially a jealousy thing, but I'm more, I'm not a man of high morals, but I sure like to kind of push my make-believe morals on people, you know? Like, the morals that I don't have, I apply to other people.
You use them in weird places.
Yeah, so, like, that's... So, I'll do that all the time. I'll text you. If I see somebody steal a tweet from somebody else, I'll text you. I'll be like, did you see that person take that person's tweet? They're going to hell.
I think here is where kind of the importance lies, is that dude's tweet wasn't funnier than yours.
Right. Yeah.
If somebody took that embedded the tweet and made it into took your video and made it into a better tweet,
yes,
I'm completely cool with that. So, but to vulture off somebody's joke and then just like take it as your own, that is where that's where I draw the line.
You know what it is? Embedding a tweet, if you do that, because it's different from a quote tweet, because a quote tweet, someone still needs to go and click on your tweet to play the media.
Yeah.
An embed tweet is, if you're doing it the right way, it's because you're turning that video into a meme. You're making that a standard, you know? So if it was some fun video and you embedded it with, like, me every Tuesday, people be like, oh, shit, that's funny because that relates to that guy's Tuesdays or whatever. But if you're just passing it along with no... It's similar to... For those of us who live in the text tweeting world, when someone reports something and then someone quote tweets it with, wow. Or someone quote tweets it with, and there it is.
Right.
And it's like, motherfucker, just boom. Hit straight
yeah,
retweet.
I know.
So I saw that, and it was a lot of heat, a lot of stuff going on. People were tweeting to me about it. It was getting fast and furious, quite frankly. I had pointed out that person took it. I did a quote tweet with a lot of the emojis.
Yeah.
And it was getting really hot really fast. So I moved. So I was in viral Twitter, getting all out of control. And I pivoted to a safer Twitter that I knew better, which is Meltdown Twitter.
Oh, yeah. That is your bread and butter.
And I was like, okay.
You spent about 5 minutes in viral Twitter before you went straight to Meltdown Twitter.
that's the thing. Like, that it obviously wouldn't do as well because it is more of an inside joke between us. But when you, like, the hardest I laughed on Twitter all day was when you were like, well, folks, it took DJ about 5 minutes in viral Twitter before he shaved his head. And it was like I just learned a lot about Twitter. I learned a lot about Bruntouchables because they were.
Oh man, they came out with the they came out swinging.
I was doing like the caps lock kind of meltdown, which generally for me. So Father John Misty had the rule where if the tweet is in cap locks, it means I'm like drunk and crying or something. If the tweet is in caps locks, it means that I'm being an asshole, but I'm aware that I'm being an asshole.
Yes.
So like it was tongue in cheek, but also. Again, I'm fucking.
The message was serious.
Police. Yeah, right. Mm-hmm. So,
the guy who stole it handled it wildly wrong. I think he took it and he took his punches from the Bruntouchables. They were handing them out.
Yeah.
But then he followed it up with, "If you like this tweet." Follow my podcast.
So that's what. So him and his podcasting sidekick were hard on the doing pub thing. So that was of my meltdown tweets. That was the one that I was serious. I quote tweeted like the son of a bitch followed it up with if you like this.
If you like this stolen content.
If you like this, then fuck. So like people were responding that hard with like if I like this, I'll fucking keep following DJ asshole.
Yeah.
So. That happened, and I was tweeting about that, and then his podcasting buddy hit me with a hard care to come on the podcast and discuss the guy who did it, the guy who committed the act, and I've since spoken to him. I told him, I said, I'm not going to drag you. I'm going to drag the fuck out of the act. he follows both of us on Twitter.
Listens to
by
Brunch.
By all means, listens to Brunch, or by all indications, listens to Brunch. Tweeted after, he was like, wow, I'm going to get my ass kicked by the Bruntouchables. People were threatening to hit him with the hard one-star reviews. It was, they were really angry, and they were fucking passionately angry about it.
Yeah, well, I mean, the thing that bothered me the most was how proud he was of stealing the content.
He pinned
the tweet.
Yeah, I think he pinned it before I pinned it.
God. Pinned the tweet, and then, like, promoted his podcast based on stolen content. So, like... That rubbed me the wrong way.
It was quite disgusting, but with
quite disgusting.
Yeah,
it was quite problematic.
I was yes, it was very obscene. So it was funny because the responses to that guy's tweet, like the first like 10 were like, "You have stolen this," and so I DM'd him after because you texted me, you were like, he deleted the tweet, and. This shows how fucked up I am, because I was like, no, this is terrible, this guy's going to hell, you can't do this, and then you were like, he deleted the tweet, and I was like, aww.
Yeah, you're like, oh man, I feel bad, and I was like, what the fuck, man?
He's the bad guy.
He stole your joke.
Yeah. So, I shot him a DM, and I was like, hey, like I said, I'm not gonna drag you, I'm for sure gonna drag that act, because I'm not here for that bullshit. But yeah, I mean, he seems like a nice guy. Dude, if that's like the shadiest thing that guy's done, then
yeah,
he's
like,
an
whatever.
Angel.
Yeah.
So I like him. I seriously do. Like, swapped a couple
friendship
messages.
Friendship forged.
He was like, yo, that was really funny. And obviously he liked it if...
that's fine.
If he stole it. So
DJ had a meltdown.
I had a meltdown.
He's okay now.
Again, never again.
never again
with the viral...
I'll take your viral tweets. I can handle
it. Well, I meant to say that. There's only one person who I'm okay with just, like, straight up jacking something from me, and that would be you. Because you and I, like, consult each other and kind of workshop, especially if it's something that's kind of, like, our shared humor, it's... Like if I think like if you think of something that would be funnier for me to tweet than you, you'll be like, tweet this.
Yeah.
Or if like there's like a thing that would do better in hockey Twitter if it came from you, I'll be like something along these lines, you know. And it's never like there's never like the need to tweet something then follow it up with like hat tip to Pete, thanks for helping me out.
No, definitely not. No.
Because it's like we fucking
this is like a tandem operation.
You know what? It's like a couple fucking like going to a pizza place. Like, we get each other's slices, and it's like, you'll get the next one, whatever.
Yeah, right,
I'm sure
yeah.
we're even enough. But
we've probably actually done that in real life.
What?
Like, Dubai,
oh, we'll get
yeah,
each other
yeah.
next time? Yeah. Oh, well, I guess, speaking of spending money, how about this video that should be out at some point today, if it's not out already, this Halloween video.
Halloween, everybody. We made a video for the third year in a row.
Yeah, this is the best one of the three.
This is the best one for sure. The first one was an absolute abomination.
The first one was the first time we realized that brunch cannot be good.
can be bad.
It's yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like it's possible for us to do something and it isn't good.
The feeling that I got after doing the first Halloween video that we did was very demoralizing because we had great people. It was me, you, Jared Carabas, and Jeff Israel. Hi, Jeff. We love you. It was us four in a room, and we kind of just like we
didn't have a plan at
all. We were arrogant. We were like, we'll just sit down and have a conversation, and it'll turn into great content.
Yeah,
it did not. It was bad.
Yeah,
we got like maybe a minute of usable content out of like a 90-minute discussion.
Yeah. Do you remember after that? That was like a big moment in brunch for me. Do you remember after that?
We kind of like consoled each other and
you were walking to your car.
Don't get your head down.
Yeah, we had like, hey, before you go, it was like, man, you don't even need to say it. It was like, because at that point, we'd only done a few episodes, but right off the bat, we were like, oh, yeah, this is going to be a good thing. Like, this is going to be a funny, like, stupid thing that we do. And when we did that, it was like, don't forget. Overall, this is a good thing that we're doing.
This is a bump of the road.
Yeah.
This one, I'm very excited about this one. I'm excited to see how it comes out. We haven't put it together yet, but we have all the shots and stuff. We just finished. We wrapped on filming.
Yeah.
Which was a really cool thing to do because once we finished filming, we actually said, "That's a wrap."
Yeah.
And so it felt official. I feel really good about it.
Me too. Our pal Miles helped us with it. He shot a lot of it. He played the man in the straitjacket, and he was, afterwards we were like, fuck, because at the last minute we were like, you know, we should get a third person to help us out with it, and then when it ended we were like, fuck, if we did not have a third person.
This would have sucked.
Because there was just like, all the shots were moving, and I don't know, I can't see this coming out poorly, because we normally, like, we're obviously pretty self-conscious, and we did all of these pretty much, except for like one or two of them, were just one take. We just like shot it, played it back, and we were like, stupid, awesome, keep going.
There's a lot of inside jokes, a lot of stupid stuff. So like people who religiously listen to this podcast will for sure enjoy it.
That's that's
anybody coming in raw or new is not going to enjoy most of it, I think. I don't know, maybe, but they're not going to get the jokes.
No, that's like my favorite shit, though. And it's like what I was saying before, like if I tweet something and if I could word it a little bit differently and it'll appeal to like 300 more people, I'm like, just like, no,
nah.
I like it this way.
I like my four friends.
No, honestly, like I was actually, so I was driving Miles home afterwards, and he was asking about, like, how many listeners do you guys have and stuff like that. And I was like, we have X amount of listeners, and I feel like I know all of them.
Yes.
And I like all of them. And that is fucking wild. Like, nobody has ever responded to one of our episodes with, like, how dare you say that about the president? You know, like, it's just, like, all people who want to be doing this shit.
And also, like, nobody's ever been like, hey, that wasn't a good episode. Like, this was a disappointing episode.
Right.
Nobody's really said that. And we appreciate it because we know that we've had disappointing episodes.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like we can gauge the quality of the podcast pretty instantaneously after we finish.
We're usually wrong, though, when we're like, that was
like, not that good.
Actually bad. And those will be the ones where we actually get compliments. Because a lot of times we won't get compliments, so it'll just be like a when so and so said this, and then a gif of somebody throwing up or whatever. And but yeah, I mean, you I don't know how that got to that point, but you guys fucking rule. So
you can check that out.
Yeah, this video is something that you guys, the people who are really into it, hopefully like, because it's all it is fucking references.
Yes.
So
where are we putting it? YouTube?
YouTube,
right?
YouTube, Instagram, probably some Twitter.
We'll put clip shows on Instagram. But probably the full thing will only be on YouTube. So
you'll
find it on Twitter.
People are going to request the music as a ringtone.
I hope so.
Hmm.
Now that you said that, probably.
Hmm.
Nice little, you planted the seed. Good for you.
Yeah. So. There's no way that this video's not going to fucking roll. So that's quite exciting. Stranger Things is back. Stranger Things. And neither of us were able to get through the whole thing, not for lack of quality. Effort. I think that it is awesome. I'm 6 episodes in?
I'm about 5, so we're pretty close.
Yeah. I'll say so far I like this season better than the first season.
Really?
Yeah, I love this.
Okay. I would say I wouldn't put it that high. I think it's a little behind first, but I'm definitely enjoying it. By the way, this is we're not going to spoil anything because we already had people ask us, are you going to spoil?
Yeah, generally there's one thing that I'm kind of dwelling on, but there's two, but they're not spoilers.
No, I tweeted something when I was watching it this weekend, and somebody was like, oh, whoa, spoiler alert. And I was like, that has nothing to do with the plot. I'll say it right now. It was Mike's sister. What's her name?
I don't care.
Mike's sister is at Barb's house, Barb's family's house.
Yeah.
And she goes in the bathroom.
What a couple of downers those guys
are. I know. What are they? Is their daughter just die or something? She goes in the bathroom and they have a photo of Barb in the bathroom. And I was like, why are Barb's parents putting photos of her in the bathroom? Do they really need Barb looking at them while they're taking a shit? And some person responded and was like, whoa, spoiler alert. And I was like, Barb died in season one.
Yeah.
This is not a fucking spoiler alert. It doesn't mean anything. So people are fucking freaking
out. That reminds me, that terrible twisted Barb humor that we just did. I kind of caught myself not doing, I was doing brunch to non-brunch people.
When?
On Saturday night, where like a lot of, for some reason, it's okay for us to make fun of Paul Walker now.
You know, I mean, we made it okay for ourselves,
like,
I guess.
Like somehow we got to this kind of weird
we got
point
away with it,
where it's just like, oh yeah, whatever.
Well, the thing is, like, I think the way that we got away with it is that like Paul Walker has been memorialized so many times that we kind of have to like even it out. Yeah.
So I'm standing around at this gathering, and someone says to kind of the group, "So what do you think of Tom Petty dying?" And I just, like, instinctively said, I think it's true. And, like, no, like, 0.0 laughs, but also 0.0, like,
that
was
not
okay.
Okay.
It was just, like, no fucking reaction to this fucking
I think
idiot.
That's more of, like, a shock thing. Nobody expects that to be said.
Right, but, like...
Also, like, if you're asking, what do you think about Tom Petty dying? Like, what the fuck are you supposed to answer that with? Like,
pro.
Very pro dead Tom Petty.
All done. So my big takeaway... First of all, I gotta shout out fucking Randy. I forgot how good a fucking actor he is. And every time I see him in anything, that's always my takeaway. Then I'm like, fuck, I forget that you're a actor.
I'm kind of conflicted about it because when I see him on screen... and like, he's right away in season 2 of Stranger Things. They are like, we need to get Randy on screen immediately. But I feel conflicted when he's on screen because I'm like, I don't even know that guy. That's not the guy that I know.
That's true.
Yeah, and so like it's his first I want to be like, that's my best friend, but yeah. I can't because I don't even fucking recognize that guy. He's really Mr. Clark.
Somebody completely different.
Yes.
He's acting. He's so fucking cheery and like... There's such a pep in his step the whole time, and he's a science teacher, so all the people are taking us in, with the exception of the AV kids, don't fucking care about this, but he's so chipper, and he's got his all aboard Max thing, and oh god, I fucking love
him. I love you, Randy.
Yeah, so good.
Also, when I was watching Stranger Things Season 2, I was watching it with my mother, mm-hmm. And when Randy came on screen, she said, he's handsome, and so I... came very close to tweeting at Randy, and I said, I was going to say, hey, Randy, my mom says you're very handsome, and also, she's single. Which I thought better of it because my mom's probably like 20 or 30 years older than Randy, and I think it's kind of weird if I'm like trying to like pimp out my mom to Randy.
Well,
so I didn't want to make Randy uncomfortable.
Well,
so.
I had a
Randy,
weird Twitter
my
day.
Mom thinks you're cute.
I sent out a tweet screen grabbing my mom texting me saying she saw me on TV and she texted me.
Oh, yeah, I did see that.
I think you look cute.
Yes.
So I very poorly covered up the mom with Bay and tweeted out when Bay thinks you look cute.
That was funny. I like that.
So, but that's what I liked because that got like 16 likes, 2 retweets.
But I really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed it. But yeah, I would, hey, Randy, you want to be my dad?
Yo, God, that would fucking... I'd be fucking pissed.
You would be so mad. If Randy got
to be your dad, I'm like, we were all on the same fucking level. Then you fucking...
And then I just like ran... Then I ramped it up and pimped out my mom, and Randy's my dad.
I'd be really mad if Randy became your dad. So my big takeaway is... My two big takeaways, I'm going to go in order from not as big a takeaway to the biggest takeaway. Not as big a takeaway, Strange Things got money.
Oh, yeah, they do have money.
They got money. They buy in songs.
What the fuck did you expect?
Remember, they tried to cast Father John Misty or Josh Tillman.
Yeah, what the fuck?
He would have been good.
He would have been great.
I was watching it, and when I saw Brett Gelman, I was like, fuck.
That was a takeaway of mine, by the way. Brett Gelman.
Yeah.
Fucking love him.
Terrific. Small little take on him. How come in all these fucking things, all these like kind of like horror movies or anything where adults are interacting with children, there's always an inappropriately aged adult who really wants the children to have sex with each other.
Who did that? Brett Gelman?
Fuck. It's the most recent episode. It's fucking, it's homegirl and, that's not a spoiler. It's homegirl and...
Mike's sister?
And Mike's, no, and it's Mike's sister and Will's brother.
Okay.
Who, like, there's obviously...
There's tension there, yes.
The whole time, anyway.
But what's his name's brother? What's his name?
Will?
Yeah, Will's brother just got arrested for cocaine possession or...
Oh, that's what, I assumed it was Steve.
No, it was Will's brother.
Well,
I don't know if he was arrested, but he was denied access to the United States.
Well,
that guy likes to party. That guy looks like a dude who is on drugs. That dude is a very strange looking person.
Well, I need to know now whether or not I need confirmation that Steve is also doing cocaine because I think that Steve kind of needs that little rock star.
Steve is for sure. Like he thinks he knows that he's hot shit.
Yeah, and he's got big hair in a way that. Like, other people with big hair can't even imagine. Like, I pump my shit up, but I look at that guy's hair, and I'm like, you are fucking magnificent, dude.
the mini Ben Schwartz.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah.
Do you want to know my biggest takeaway?
Well, I want to get... I have a Brett Gelman take. I love Brett Gelman, and you made a good point. You were like, what is he in?
What are we supposed to identify
him? Yeah, what is he in that is why we love him so much? Because I for sure love him. I think it was Joshy that really sold me on him. But like I can't really... I watched his movie that he starred in. It was called Lemon. And it was one of the worst movies that I've ever seen in my life.
Not a great name for a movie that you want people to not say was disappointing.
Well, the Lemon is... like, he's a lemon in that movie. Like, he has a million things wrong with him.
Wow.
And that movie was terrible, but I still fucking love Brett Gelman. I can't tell you why. I think it's just Joshy. Mm. And if anybody is somewhat new to this podcast and haven't heard us talk about Joshy, go fucking watch it because that movie is unbelievable.
Fun relationship tip, everybody. Sometimes, behind your significant other's back, call them a lemon.
Yikes. Don't do that.
Be like, oh, man. He's really a real lemon.
Yeah. That'll go over well. Go ahead.
Yeah. One time someone called someone else's girlfriend, like, it was back when Cash for Clunkers existed.
Oh, God, a clunker.
They were like, oh, man, she's a clunker.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
They were talking about her personality.
Well.
But they were still wrong. So my biggest takeaway with Stranger Things is that Millie Bobby Brown... Obviously, we're all very protective of Millie Bobby Brown. That's like all of our daughter.
Yeah.
She's like Madonna now. Have you noticed the way with which she does her like mind things where she'll like slam a door?
Yeah.
She'll do it very like theatrical.
Yes.
And like very like throws the head back and God, I wish this were video because like it's so fucking dramatic. I think it's hilarious.
I think it's great, but I also think that it makes sense because she's like harnessed that power, and she feels in control with it now.
She feels so empowered.
Yes, so I think it makes sense. Like she knows what she can do, and she's throwing a little extra flair on it. I don't hate it.
Right, because like I know she's obviously a great actress, so it's not this, but kind of in my head, I like to think that because she's a fucking rock star now, obviously.
Yeah.
So that she was in the first season, she was this quiet little kid. Got this part, and then she became a huge
super
thing.
Famous.
Fucking what's his face? Aaron Paul's like all up in her shit. So now she does all of her scenes. like she's like a prima donna now.
And I like that they gave Hopper a dance scene.
Yeah, when?
When they're cleaning up the shack.
Oh yeah.
And they gave Hopper a dance scene, and now there's a Twitter account. Hopper dances too.
Really?
And then they just put different music on it, and they just like play that same video over all different songs.
Don't use, someone will steal it.
True. Yeah. Good call.
I think that Hopper's great this season. I think that everyone's great this season, with the exception of one character.
Sean Astin.
Oh, well, Sean Astin. That goes without saying. We both texted each other like at the same time, like, fuck Sean Astin forever. Why is he in?
What did you do? You had like a really strong text to me. I think it was like, Sean Astin, get out of my life forever.
Probably.
Something like that. And I was like, yes.
Probably.
Has anybody like liked Sean Astin in anything?
Well,
I think it's just his like fucking overbite and just the way that he carries himself. He's never likable.
Well, I was thrown for a loop because I didn't mind him. So he was obviously in Rudy, and then years later he was in Star Wars.
Yes.
We
knew where you were going with that one.
But that's wild that we both picked the same one, because I could have said Harry Potter.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, he did Rudy, Star Wars, and then he was in 24. Now, I think that by the time he was in 24, people were sick of his shit. I didn't care enough about Star Wars to really kind of experience the... I'd seen him in it, but I wasn't like invested in him.
Yeah.
So when he was in 24,
you knew that
I
was
like,
in it.
Good for Rudy. Okay, nice. And then, spoiler alert, in case you haven't seen the like season 5 of 24, which
like
was like
19
years
ago.
Yeah. He gave... what did he do? Oh, his junkie sister said, I need you to loan me some money. So she goes to meet him outside of CTU, and when he takes out his wallet, her and her boyfriend beat him up and take his wallet. So he thinks, oh, they're taking my money. But really what they were doing is they were taking his CTU key card because someone wanted to buy it from them. The person that went to buy it from them then executed both of them. Shouldn't have fucking done that move. And then they used the key card to bring Centox nerve gas into CTU. All the nerve gas goes off. Everybody dies, including Edgar Styles. All Rudy's fault. Fuck you, Sean.
Rudy killed Edgar Styles.
Yes, he straight up
Edgar
did.
Styles.
And it sucks that when we have Randy on, we're going to have to act like, Randy, earmuffs, we're going to have to act like, oh, how is Sean Astin to work with? And he's going to, of course, Sean Astin, I'm sure, is the best guy in the world.
He probably
is. I bet that
dude
is humble as fuck.
Yeah.
He's like,
he's been in everything. He was in Toy Soldiers when he was like 12 years old.
Well, he was in two of like the biggest movies ever. Or he was in one of the biggest movies ever and then one of the biggest franchises ever.
Lord of the Star Wars. And what was the first one?
Like, well, Rudy's like a classic.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
That's true. Yeah.
So he's been in these iconic things. And I guarantee that, and I'm not just saying this because we're talking shit about him, I guarantee he's like the nicest, coolest dude in the world. But for some reason, I honestly think it's because he got Edgar Styles killed. Chloe.
I think it's kind of sad that, like, I think it's sad that he's still acting because he's only in like one thing every 5 to 10 years. Mm. And so when I see him, I'm like, is this guy like actively trying to act? Or is he just like really, is he like turning down roles and picking his spots? I don't know. That's always like a tough thing when somebody just shows up randomly and you're like, oh, I forgot that person existed.
Right. He's a big, like Charlie Kelly and Mac would make him the lead of their next script. Remember when they write the script and they're like, we need to bring somebody back. Who are we going to bring back? Dolph Lundgren.
Yeah.
Sean Astin would be the guy.
He's for sure like a guy to bring back.
Because he plays... So, again, it's weird. I don't mind his character. I don't mind how he plays his character. I think I'm just like, ugh, Sean Astin. I think that character is important because Will needs the kind of grown-up version of himself to kind of play all of his things off of. But this takes me to my bigger point. At some point, we've all just... They've got to cut bait with Will.
Oh, Jesus. That's your big point?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, I don't necessarily think that that's a wrong take. I think I'm worried where
just
the...
Just like one time, don't rush him to the hospital.
Oh, Jesus. I'm a little bit worried that we're heading towards a dangerous place with the kids. Because in the first season, the kids were obviously like the gems of the show. And like they didn't do anything wrong in the first season. They were just like very innocent, very like they were trying to get to all the right places. They had all good intentions and shit like that. I'm only 5 episodes deep. Dustin, for sure, a big dummy.
There's a lot of selfishness starting. Like, yes. Like guys are starting to think for themselves. Yes. Lucas is hot on Max's trail. Dustin is all about his quote-unquote discovery. Yo, congrats, man. You discovered a fucking monster. Like, quit bragging about it. It's going to kill all you guys. How much of Dustin being a big part of this season is that, like Millie Bobby Brown, he became a star, so it's like, all right, he moves up the hierarchy.
Yeah, I think that, well, I mean, if that was true, Finn Wolfhard would be, like, the real star.
Right, they would have, like, pushed everybody out. It would have just been the Millie Bobby Brown, Finn Wolfhard hour.
They would have, like, started, like, a romance with them or something.
So I just realized I'm going to be that guy. I'm going to be the problematic adult that's trying to push two kids in love, but, like,
they kind of already are in love, so.
I need them to be the Justin and Brittany.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know if I like or dislike the fact that what's his real name?
Who?
Dustin.
Gatton Mazzaro?
I don't know if I like or dislike that they gave him teeth.
Yeah, that's he still got his lisp.
He still has his lisp, but
Michael Bublé
the teeth,
talking ass.
The teeth thing was like did they ever really get
Michael
to,
Bublé
like,
has a lisp, by the way. Congratulations, everybody. You're not going to be able to hear
ruined again. Michael Bublé for everybody. Yeah. I don't know. Did they ever get to the part to like explaining how he just like randomly got teeth?
No. Puberty.
Well, because like he in real life, he has like a disease or something that his teeth didn't grow.
Really?
Yeah. So those are for sure fake teeth.
Oh, that's weird then.
Yeah, it was like I'm this might be incorrect, but I'm pretty sure that like he had some issue that like his teeth didn't grow, and then like he obviously just like made some money off Stranger Things and got that corrected, and they kind of glazed over it. But I guess that it kind of makes sense in the you lose your teeth way earlier than eighth grade.
Which teeth? Like the
front teeth?
Yeah, like the old shitty ones.
Yeah, like you lose those probably when you're in second or third grade.
Yeah, I when I was in middle school, I ripped out one of my teeth because I got a now and later stuck to it. And I was like, whatever, the tooth's coming out. And they were like, dude, like those teeth fucking came out forever ago. You just fucking ripped out one of your real teeth, idiot. And yeah, good times. Dude, fucking now and laters, can you blame me? When you get a now and later stuck to your tooth,
you fucking go for it, man.
That was I remember. I was
I'm
like,
just impressed that you could actually.
Too many damn times, I'm done.
I'm impressed that you were actually able to rip out an adult tooth. With an now and later. An issue that came up when I was watching Stranger Things, when I was watching the first episode, I was watching it and it gave me the option to skip the intro.
Oh yeah, that's hilarious.
Yeah, I was like, do you really think that I would ever fucking skip the intro to Stranger Things ever, ever? And especially the first time after not seeing it for like a year.
Yeah.
So that made me to think, is the skip intro button a good or bad thing for
TV? I'm super glad you brought that up. It's good, but you have to know how to use its powers for good. Because you can definitely use them for evil. If you need to have heard the intro of any show that you care about, you need to have heard it about 600 more times than you wanted to. So you know it's
you
so
need to
intimately
know every fucking note,
yes,
every
core
detail.
Yeah. Right, and you do. Like, everyone, there's a reason why everyone, when there's any sort of clapping joke,
Friends.
The Friends thing. Yep. Because of that. You've
it's
heard
iconic.
It too many times. the office, the ba 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 at the end. It's just you've wanted to skip over it so many times, but you weren't able to. So now you have the option, but you need to force yourself to. If you're like new with the show, you can't skip to the fucking
Right. You definitely need to have an appreciation of it. But I also think that there are certain shows where you should never skip the intro. Like, it's disrespectful to if an intro is so good that it becomes iconic. Stranger Things is definitely in there. If it's so good, you should never skip it.
What's the number one skippable intro?
Number one skippable intro. Mm-hmm. Is it a Netflix show?
Yes. I think I would do it for the first episode of a season, and probably after that.
I want to say Mindhunters, because the Mindhunters one is terrible. Mm-hmm. I don't like it at all, but I don't think that you're there. Narcos?
House of Cards. 2 hours long. That's the longest intro in the world.
House of Cards is very, very long. Also, another long one. It's not bad, but The Sopranos. I for sure would skip The Sopranos.
Yeah.
It's really long.
Here's the one where you can't do it because the option doesn't exist because it's not on Netflix, is The Wire, because it's got a different theme song every year.
Yeah, so they keep it fresh.
I like The Wire. I've rewatched it. That's not true. I've rewatched certain episodes.
I've rewatched The Wire all the way through.
So I need to do that a couple times.
I think I've done it like 3 or 4 times.
So because I've only heard each theme song like 12 times. So for a show that I reference all the time and that I love, it's weird that I don't have it completely down. Best fucking, the two best theme songs for shows, excluding anything done by Donny Hathaway, because he's obviously perfect. So shouts, Maude. Number one, Family Matters.
Okay.
Best. You know that one?
Yep.
Number two, fucking Cosby Show season. I think it's 4. That's, what's his face? The Don't Worry, Be Happy guy.
I know there are for sure theme songs that I would never want to skip. Like, The Office is in there.
The Office I will for sure skip.
Are you serious?
The Office, when I rewatch it, I manually know how to skip it. Like, I got the feel down. Yeah.
I fucking love The Office
theme. Oh, it's terrific. But God, I've watched an episode of The Office probably 800 times.
I don't care. I'm watching the theme song every time.
Huh.
Also, actually, the peak for me might be Parks and Rec. Parks and Rec's theme song is fucking unbelievable.
Parks and Rec, you can't ever want to miss that. You know, did you ever watch Community?
No.
The Community had a song by the 88 it was a really good theme song, or it was really good to be used for a theme song, and it was a very short clip of it, so it was perfect. Kind of what we do. We don't go long with our fucking intros or theme songs or anything, because we want to give you the good, the juicy
meat.